Praise the Lord. Amen. Absolutely beautiful. Mm-hmm. You know, and I was about to say, because I didn't get to hear the English yet, and I was going to say, they can't leave until they tell us what it's about. And I got to hear it with you. Praise the Lord. Beautiful. Thank you, ladies. My heart is already filled. Your heart is filled? Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. What a wonderful time. This morning, it's a blessing and a privilege for me to be with you, to have this time. We're going to be going through a series of studies on Believe. We Believe, I call it, series, with the elders. They're partnering with me to share with you beliefs that we as Seventh-day Adventists have and hold, not just here at the Cocoa Seventh-day Adventist Church, Titusville, not just in America, but all over the world. Our numbers have grown through the years from when the Advent movement first started out. We're 19 million and adding. And we believe it's important that we understand, who are we? What are we about? What do we believe, you know? How many here were not raised in the Seventh-day Adventist faith? Could you put your hands up? Okay, number, maybe half. And those who already were raised, first generation, second generation, third, some of you might even be fourth generation. Thank you so much for giving us feedback. You know, our beliefs, what we hold to. There's a song I'd like for take this moment and share with you. You might have heard it on our radio stations, Christian radio stations. It's called We Believe. The Newsboys, they sing this song, and we were able to get a version on YouTube. We want to show you, and we ask that we sing along, because it has to do with doctrinal beliefs. And so let's do that right now. And yes, we'll get the lights. Thank you so much. As we get this ready, we join. You might need to raise the volume, and if you want to sing along, sing along. Let's do that.
In this time of desperation, all we know is doubt and fear. There is only one foundation. We believe. We believe. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. We believe. We believe.
Many of these are sung by Christians everywhere. Much of what you just heard, other Christians believe. We believe in these things. I love the fact, and I would think, well, were there Adventists putting that one in there, huh? We believe He's what? Coming back again? Yeah. And you know that that's shared by many others too. We believe Jesus Christ is the one who died, He rose, and He's coming again. In fact, there's more things that we also believe. We believe in a number of teachings that we find in the scripture. In fact, we refer to them as fundamental beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. 28 fundamental beliefs. I'm clicking as much as I can, but I believe this is not working. Let's see. What we believe. You know, many of you have gone, and might have heard, others have not, Adventist.org, www.adventist.org. is our official church website, and you can find the fundamental beliefs of the Adventist Church. We have 28 fundamental beliefs. Years ago we had, 27, right? And we've added one more. Now I can share with you a little bit about Adventist beliefs, and in fact, there is Signs of the Times has a special edition, and it lists all those beliefs in there. And I'm going to see about getting copies. Would you like to have a copy of this for yourselves? I'm invited, and we've partnered together with our elders, that we're going to go through these. We're going to open the scriptures. We're going to look at passages. It's important that we know, what do we believe? What are we about? Because if we lose sense of that, if we do not have a grasp, then we're like the gentleman. A gentleman that I read about. And I'll give you an example of this. He was a young, devout, unmarried seminarian, newly graduated. He knew what he believed, and he valued sincerity, truth, and honesty. By the way, those are wonderful qualities, right, to have? Until one day when he boarded a plane, he was sitting there, he noticed a beautiful young lady coming down the aisle. He found it hard not to stare as she just drew him in, her beauty, her attractiveness. And sure enough, what did he do? What do you think he would have done? He sat down right next to her. Then she opened the Bible and she started to read. As soon as she opened the Bible, he said, "There is a God in heaven and He is smiling upon me." He started a conversation with her, and he started, you know, to look carefully, and he checked to see, does she have a wedding ring? No, she doesn't have one. And after some casual talk, he decided to be even more direct. He asked her, "What kind of men do you like?" And she said, "Oh, that's an interesting question. This may be unexpected, but I like Native American men. They really have a sense of heritage and history. They know who they are, and they're powerful." But, she continued, "I've known some Jewish fellows also. Well, they have a sense of morality and heritage and principle. I really enjoy their friendship. Still, you know what? I gotta be honest with you," she goes on and says, "my favorite kind of guy is just a country boy. You know, they're honest, they're down to earth, and they're easy to know." Well, you know, that young man, that seminarian, was deep in thought. And he decided he was going, when she asked him a question, here's the question she asked. By the way, what is your name? And the young man, having their temporary loss of his memory and everything, of value, he moves closer to her and he says, oh, my name is Geronimo Goldstein, but my friends just call me Bubba. What was he doing? He was morphing, right? Because he, and you know that happens, and that's just a funny story illustration where we lose sight. We have this belief, but we transition and we become something else. Jesus often addressed religious leaders in his day, and he spoke to them about the contradiction of their own lives, that what they believed and how they lived. In fact, it's not working, so you're gonna have to help me along. I shared about the fundamental beliefs, and I'll come back to that a little later. Let's move on. This says in Luke chapter 6, 46, can you all see it? Can you read it with me? Why do you call me what? Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say? And Paul wrote to Titus a letter, and it speaks of those who profess one thing but do another. So let's look at that one. Let's read it. They profess to know God, but by their deeds they what? Deny Him. Being detestable and disobedient and worthless for any good deed. You see, the task before us, if we're to live an integrated, and you know, think about integrated, or what's another word we get for like integrated? What's another word? Integrity? What's integrity? I'm going to ask you right here. You know, earlier we were talking in Sabbath school that we don't always, of course, during sermon time have an opportunity to participate, and that's why the lesson study, but I want to give you an opportunity. What's integrity? Yes, Stephanie.
Doing the right thing when
no one else is looking. Very good, very good. Anybody want to add to that? Yes.
Honesty,
right? You know, it comes from the word integer. What's an integer? It's a whole number, isn't it? And so it means to be whole. And so Jesus, he was addressing the fact that even in his days, and I would say it happens even today, there is what we declare, we believe, and there is what we demonstrate. So I declare this, but I what? Demonstrate. In fact, there it goes. This is life, right? If you declare something and you demonstrate that which you declare, what do you have?
Integrity.
You're a whole person. You're consistent. You're one thing in public, but you're also the same thing in private, right? Well, let's look at the next one. Now, here's the opposite. You say something, you declare something, but you demonstrate something totally different. What do you call that? What does that equal? And I'm going to ask you this question. How many here know a hypocrite? How many, based on what you just heard, would have to say, I personally know a hypocrite? Because we don't really have to look very far, do we?
No.
Have we not at times, or maybe in our life, declared one thing and demonstrated something different?
Yes.
Right. If we're really honest, right? It calls for that. We're really honest. In fact, there is a quote I want to put up there. This is by a former senior editor of Christianity Today. I think you can read it right there. It says, a person of integrity is one who has an established system of principles against which all of his life is judged. So principles, and when you think about principles, you're thinking about belief. You're thinking about those things that an individual values. And we all have values. I mean, there are ideas, there are aspects of your life that you value. And so before we can judge our life by solid principles, we have to establish what are they. In fact, the very reason of our series of meetings on this topic is that we have to understand principles. We have to understand teachings so that we can know what is the right thing to do, so that when our moment, you know, that young man I just shared the illustration, that was a moment of truth, right? And here he is, he's a seminary. Did I ever tell you my experience? I'll share, some of you might recall, and some of you say, no, I never heard that one. You know, I was a undergrad student studying theology, and I really had a fever for driving a car. And some of you, bear with me, be patient, as I just shared, I wanted so much to drive. I didn't have a car in New York City. I didn't need a car. You got all means of transportation, every way to get around. And so here I am on the campus of one of our colleges in Massachusetts. Folks, it was so desolate, that campus. I had to walk so far to get a phone. And it was heartbreaking that when I went to get that phone, somebody had cut. Listen, how it's a long time ago. They cut the line. It was one of those phone booths back then. Some of you are like, what's a phone booth? Okay, but I was out there, and I felt really, I loved to get around. I had met Jane. Were we married at that time? Not yet. No, we weren't married at the time, and I met her, and met her sister, who later became my sister-in-law, and she had an Eldorado, right? It was a black vehicle that actually was low-riding. That was low-riding because the shocks were gone. And folks, she had taken it off, the insurance, everything. I didn't realize it, but I wanted to drive so badly. And she said, would you hold the keys to this car? And would you just wait for a gentleman who comes the next day? And this is December 24th, right? Christmas, what? Christmas Eve. And she said, he's going to come pick up the vehicle and take it for a drive. And I thought about it. I went to bed that night, but I couldn't sleep. I thought, that Eldorado's calling me. And you know what I did? I did what I should not do. What does the Bible say? Thou shalt not, what? Steal, right? But I was just borrowing. Or I thought, I'm just borrowing. And so I thought, let me get in that car. And I stole so much. You know, when I finally was pulled over by the police officer who was following me all around that area, I was going up and down hills, and I thought, that vehicle behind me, let me roll down the window. You can go. Just keep going. But I just kept following me, and I thought, you know, this is great. I blasted the radio, had the windows down. It was cruising, you know. And then when he pulled me over and he said, license and registration, I said, oh, no, I don't have that. And then he said, could I please see your, you know, insurance? And I said, oh, she doesn't have insurance in here. He said, no, it doesn't, huh? And then he said, do you realize there's no plate? Oh, it fell off. He said, no, there's no plate in the back. And then he said, what do you have? And I said, I have nothing but my student ID card. And I gave it to him. You know what? See, that is an example of declaring something and doing something totally the opposite. So I stand before you as realizing that I too have walked in hypocrisy. I too have struggled. And I use that in a bit comical, but I gotta tell you, I went to court eventually, and all I could recite was the principles of the Lord, the promises of God. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. And God delivered me. You know how many times God has to step in and do things for us, right?
Yeah.
And you know, and it was foolish. So this whole thing about incongruence, not being consistent, is there. It says in a passage, and I don't believe I have it up there. Let's go to the next one and see if I have it up there. But prove yourselves. We did that. No, okay, James chapter 1, verse 22. Prove yourselves what? Doers of the word and not merely hearers. See, God wants that we don't only hold to a body of beliefs, but that it holds what? Holds us. That it's actually part of who we are. It's like, you know, when somebody says, you know, you are what you eat. And it's amazing. Have you ever had tuna? I have had tuna. Let me tell you, after I've had tuna, I smell like tuna. I do. It's amazing how it sticks. And so I'm not here on a commission for the industry or anything, but I just got to tell you, you do become what you consume. And God intends that if we consume the principles and the teachings of His Word, that it will actually adhere and it will actually be found in us. There's a verse later that states, and it says, if anyone thinks himself to be religious and yet does not what? Bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this man's religion is what? Worthless. Worthless. So you can imagine, you know, it's like you and I can teach people, we can talk to them, we can go with any one of the fundamental beliefs, and we could say to somebody, we believe, I believe this, but the way I conduct myself, the way I treat a person, what that does, it nullifies, it throws out everything because it's not consistent. First of all, it's not consistent with what we just said. It's not consistent with the way Jesus lived His life, right? His life was intact. I was reading a passage and it said that Jesus has integrity. You believe that? Jesus was not divided. In fact, He said, I have not come to what? Do away with the law, but I've come to fulfill. Now, what does it mean He came to fulfill? He came to show us what it looks like. And I love the music we heard and the fact that earlier we're talking about the sweetness of Jesus, that consistency in His life, that He not only spoke truth, He lived truth. He not only talked about forgiveness, He forgave. He not only talked about compassion, He showed compassion. And so we must look at our actions and our attitudes and words, that they're moving in the same direction. And you know what? This is a daily process. Every day, daily process. Because some days we say we hold to something, and we might be actually consistent there, but then we show the inconsistency. So it's a process. The tendency of the human heart is to conform to the world's system of values. I don't know about you, but I grew up listening to Elvis. Did you? How many here grew up listening to Elvis and music and all that? And I was at a recent, some of you are in denial. You did, and you didn't want to say it. You even did some Elvis movements and all that. And today, if you did, if I hadn't, you know, I'm not going to put it, but if you start moving to Elvis, and you don't want others to know the truth. Okay? But here, I went to visit our sister Shirley, and with Jim. Where's Jim? He's there, Jim, right? And we're listening to a gentleman. He had a fine voice. But who did he remind us of? Elvis, right? I'm listening. I thought Elvis is in the house. He's at a nursing home now. And we're right there, and I'm listening, and I'm thinking, wow. And he even had a little bit of shoulder movement. I can't even do it. I'm Latino, not enough. So he had this shoulder movement. I thought, wow, he must have observed. I know that sometimes the impact in our society is so great that we take the form of our surroundings. Yes. Remember Peter? What did Peter say about Jesus? He said, how much did he say he loved Jesus? What did he say he would do for Jesus? He would do whatever. He would even die for Jesus, right? And then he was running for his life. And not only that, when the moment came, what did he do? He said, I don't even know the guy. And so when the pressure is on, you see, he wanted to take the environment. He was thinking, if I just mingle, if I just, because the pressure's great. We got pressure in all forms, in the workplace, right? We got pressures in the school place. We got pressures, sometimes there's even pressures in church. I'm concerned. Our nation is also going through a lot of pressure. And it's like, this side is wrong, and this side is right, or this side is right, and this side is wrong, and all this stuff. And so are we a people of principle? And where do we go for those principles? Because if we turn to the multitude, I'm going to say this, and you might say, oh, he said it. But I remember this phrase, and I believe it is true. The masses are asses. Meaning, and I just insulted a whole crowd of people and everywhere. Meaning, do not allow yourselves to be swayed by popular opinion. We must be careful. We must come to know, what do we believe in? What is it that we are about? Why are we here? You know, early in his ministry, Jesus was approached one day by Satan, who said to him, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. That's Matthew chapter 4, verse 3. And he was tempted in the area of what? Physical appetite. For 40 days he went without eating. Jesus could have replied, yes, I am hungry. I think that's a good idea. He could have caved in. But what did our Savior do? He said, he counteracted the temptation by answering, it is written. Man shall not live, say with me, man shall not live by bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. He was quoting principles that are found in the scriptures, in the Torah. You know what Torah is? Torah is God. Basically, the word comes from Yahweh, which has to do like with an arrow, where it actually is pulled back and it's released, and it goes in a certain direction. Torah is God giving us direction for our life. God giving us instruction. God saying, this is the way. This is the values that I have for you. Because they're the values of God. And so, in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3, that's where Jesus was drawing from. Satan then tempted him again. It wasn't enough. And by the way, life will continue to try to put the squeeze on us. All the time, the enemy is not done with you. Hey, I got good news for you. God is not done with you and me either. Amen? Amen? So while the enemy puts pressure, his Holy Spirit, which we're studying about, to understand how God's Spirit is interceding to bring about the good work and perfect the work that he's begun. And I like to say, God, I know you're not finished, but Father, continue. Amen? Amen. I mean, I say, Lord, don't leave me, Lord. Yes. Continue. Don't give up on me. That's why David's even realized the inconsistency of his own life. You know, someone we've all read, he was a man after God's own heart. But did that heart wander? And did that heart, left to itself, go totally opposite to the will of God? Well, that's the same thing that can happen to all of us. Our hearts are prone to wander. And so Jesus was tempted later by Satan again. It says, with personal gain, by going to the pinnacle of the temple. And Satan said, throw yourself down, because it's written. You know what? He'll use even the scriptures against us. He'll use it to twist, to lead us to not really understand and hold on to the clear teaching of God. It is written, he shall send his angels to have charge over you, and in their hands they will bear you. In other words, God will take care of you. But, you know, that's Matthew 4, verse 6. He's using scriptures in a cunning way, twisting it. He's offered Jesus an opportunity that would have been quite spectacular. But what does Jesus do? He responds, yes, it is written. It is written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. Chapter 4, verse 7. In effect, Jesus again answered, know with the knowledge that true gain comes only from doing the will of God. You and I are not to second guess God. You and I are not to try to put him in to fix. You know, I played Rubik's Cube. How many have ever done Rubik's Cube before? You know, how many here have been successful in actually solving it? Anybody here? Yeah, so, wow. You're saying yes, no. You're saying, okay, you're thinking about it. Okay, good, good. He says that your yes be yes and your no be no. There is no maybe. Okay. But I got to tell you, I have solved it. But you know how I solved it? I pried it open, and I took it apart, and I went ahead, and then I said, here, I got it. That's not the way, right? That's not the way. And so, sometimes we can be deceived to take the Word of God and try to get it to gel with our lifestyle, when in fact we need to gel with what he's saying. Amen? We need to be conformed to him. He doesn't conform to us. If you want conformed or be conformed, this is the way God did it, and it shows his humility and his love. In order to reach us where we are, God sent his only son, and he became flesh. Talk about, yes, being conformed, but without sin, amen? So that he can take us where we are and pick us up and lead us to what God intends to do with our lives. And so, there again, Jesus responds and he says no to what the enemy is saying. One more time, when offered the power, the glory, Satan said, I'll give you everything. All you have to do is bow before me. Jesus declined. He said, be gone, Satan. It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God. Him only shall you serve. He manifested the principle that real power is in worshiping God alone. Anything less is mere emptiness. And so we find Paul encouraging us, wrote to the believers back then for us today, and he said that you and I have to be careful that we're not led captive by philosophies. You see, philosophies, you know, I'll throw one out. I mean, I was raised with some of this, and I'm sure, you know, God helps those who help themselves. Oh, it's in the Bible. It's in the Bible. You'll hear people say that. That's not in the scriptures. That does not, it's not in the Word of God. But somebody thought, it sounds pretty good. I'll live by that. And others said, well, my dad lived by that. That's good enough for me. And so, you know, there's a lot of things that sometimes we're still holding to. And if we really pause, in fact, I want to take a moment. I want us to have a test, all right? Now, this is a test for you and for me, too. A test for us. Test number one. Let's go there. Test number one, your thoughts, my thoughts, okay? So say with me, my thoughts. This is about my thoughts. Since the Bible clarifies that as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. That's Proverbs 23, verse 7. Every person must ask himself this question. What dominates my thoughts? What is the central obsession of my thoughts? Just think of this week. I don't want to make it too difficult. You know, we're just going to deal with this week. What have your thoughts been on in the course of this week? And if that's too hard, okay, because that might be difficult going all the way back. Just think of yesterday, all right? Think of that. Think, what is it? What is the obsession? Because whatever that is, that is what dominates, and that is what really leads you to what you do, right? As a person thinks, so are they. All right, test number two. Let's put it up there. Time. My time. Your time. Okay? In today's world, time has become our most precious commodity. I mean, time is precious. You know, it means something. And so, and it's also a surefire indicator of our values. It is easy for us to say, I value my family. I value community service. I value exercising. Hey, you know, we came into a new year, and before that we said, oh, New Year's resolution, I want to lose weight. I want to start doing whatever I need to get in shape, right? And we said, because I got to take care. How many said, I have, my body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, and I'm getting into that gym. I'm going to start doing some activities at home and neighborhood and all that. All right? Are you doing it? Are you setting time for these things? Your family is valuable. Are you cutting out of your calendar and your daily planner time for those things that you say you value? I see, this is that moment of, you know, just personal. That's why we don't have any probes into your, we're not recording anything that's happening. It's all personal meditation and reflection. Next one, number three. Ah, You had to bring that one in, huh? What is that?
Money.
Money. My money. My money. Here's another area. You can tell what matters to someone simply by looking at their checking account. The Bible makes it clear that where what? Where your treasure is, there is your heart. And that's Matthew 6:21. Many say something to the effect, I love God's kingdom, and so I'm going to give 1% of my income. Here we have a disparity, because if you love something, when you love something, what do you give? Don't you give it priority? When you love something, you give it priority. You can't love without giving, without sacrifice. And if God is not first in the financial area of your life, what you demonstrate contradicts what you just declare. You see, there are areas of our lives that seem to not really be exactly overlapping. And you know what? We can, by the grace of God, change that. Can't we? Mm-hmm. We can. Start taking an inventory and start personally thinking, I say this, but I do. And you know what I found to be incredible? I'm not going to say do this, but if you drop dead, how many have been to funerals? You know, one of the statements that I've heard over and over, I just did one not too long ago. Someone lost their loved one, lost a family member, and said, you know what? I can't do this now with this loved one. I laid them to rest. But I would say this. Tell your family you love them. Spend time with them. Hug them. Because when all is said and done, all these other things come and go. But relationships are valuable. Amen? Amen. They're priceless. Amen. And so God is also doing that with our lives. You know, again, someone has said it before. Think with the end in mind. Because even the young who appear to have a life, a long life before them, are finding that their days are also being shortened. And so you and I need to be wise. We need to look at these things. So dealing with even the area of funds, what am I doing? The scriptures is filled with money references over and over. Jesus himself made reference to money. Because if we value God, we put all of our resources and all of our energies for his cause. Because when all is said and done, someone has said it, they have never, never, ever seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul. Right? You're not taking it with you. And so, what are we doing? Test number four, let's bring it up. My reactions, your reactions. This is an area to that also we can find and discover some things about ourselves. Here is a question. How do I react to the unexpected? You know, usually I like to think ahead that if this was to happen, what I would do. How many do that? How many here ever do that? Anybody? Okay, some you know, are thinking proactively, right? And so we usually can calculate our behavior in advance. But when unexpectedly forced, one reacts in accordance to what he or she really believes and what really matters. Have you ever been caught off guard? You didn't expect it. You know what comes out? What's really there. What's really there comes out. Because you couldn't script it. It just comes out. I mean, I've thought about, let me measure my words, and I've had moments that I got caught off guard. And something came out of me, and it was like, oh, I said that, didn't I? Aha, you said what you really felt. You said what you really thought. And so, a Christian writer, Watchman Nee, dedicated an entire chapter to the issue of Christian, he calls it the Christian reaction. He essentially states this, that you can tell much more about a person's Christianity by their reactions than by their actions. Now please, wives, husbands, parents, children, do not start to try to test your loved one and put them to the test by seeing their reaction. It's going to happen anyway, right? But these things, although we say we want to be servants of the Lord, we may revert to pride, self-protection, and even winning at any cost. Gordon MacDonald said it this way: you can tell whether you're becoming a servant by how you act when people treat you like one. Did you hear that? I'm going to read it again. You can tell whether you're becoming a servant by how you act when people treat you like one. How do I react to the unexpected? This will demonstrate my real philosophy of life. And the last one, number 5, honest evaluation from friends and family. I've heard it said, pride is like bad breath. Everyone knows you have it, but you. Not only is this true of pride, but it's also true of many other qualities in our lives we are blinded to. We all have blind spots. There are things, we have a certain image of ourselves. We have a certain view of how we're like. But if we would even be willing to be vulnerable, if we could feel maybe safe with someone in our lives, our loved ones, and ask them this question: how am I really in this area? Would you dare to do that? I think we need to feel safe. But it's important that we watch that we're not setting ourselves for a greater fall by depending on our own viewpoints and our own perspective. That's why God has given us husbands. God gave you your wife for a reason. Amen? Amen. Wives, God gave you your husband for a reason. Can you say amen to that, ladies?
Amen.
I said it, I heard it. And that's why we have parents. That's why we have folks. We have friends. Do you have friends that tell you the truth, even if it hurts? Or do you select carefully who's your friend as long as they agree with you? I'm going to say, like Mr. T, famous word, I pity the fool. We have to be able to have good, clear, honest assessment for our lives. I just told, share with church that at home, I have several mirrors, one in the bathroom. I don't like it. It shows me short, balding, and heavy. I like the one in the bedroom. I am tall and thin, and I really fit better into my clothes. But I have to realize that mirror may be off by a number of degrees. So you and I have to watch out. It is time to create alignment between what we demonstrate and what we really want to embrace as the guiding principles of our life. The best values are based on most reliable truths. The foundation, see, this book is all about truth. Amen?
Amen.
Jesus said that He is the truth, the way, and the life. And that if you and I will come to Him, He said, if the Son will set you free, what are you?
Free indeed.
He never holds back. His word is clear and wants to guide us and lead us. I want to encourage you to experience together studies on having to do with fundamental beliefs. And I'm going to close with this thought here. You remember when the Lord took Israel out of Egypt? Remember the Ten Commandments? How does the Ten Commandments start? Remember. Remember? Yes, okay. Continue that. Remember, right? Okay, you started. I am the Lord your God who took you out of the land of bondage. Now, my natural thought is to go to the first commandment, right? We call this part that we just said together, that's called the preamble. In other words, God is saying, this is what I've done for you. Therefore, here is what I desire for your life, how you are to live. Do you know that our fundamental beliefs have a preamble? And it doesn't start with all the others. It goes this way. Can you bring back and go back all the way to number 2 or 3 and bring it up there? I know you won't be able to read it. Seventh-day Adventists accept the Bible as their only creed and hold certain beliefs, fundamental beliefs, to be the teachings of the Holy Scriptures. These beliefs, as set forth from here, constitutes the church understanding and the expression of teaching of Scripture. You know, these are an expression of what we've come to understand from the Word. But how do we know if it is true? Here. This is the test of faith and practice for all of us. Amen?
Amen.
We go back to the Scriptures. We go back to what God has conveyed. God reveals His will for our lives. I just want to come down and say to you at this moment with a prayer that the very reason, do we have a mic on here? The very reason we come to study the Scriptures is because we believe that there's power in changing our lives. We believe that our founding leaders were men and women of the Word of God. That they really studied it because they were convicted in the principle, which is a Protestant Reformation principle called sola scriptura. And sola scriptura is Latin, the Word and the Word alone. And one major figure for our faith in our church, Ellen White, said that the Word and the Word alone is where we are to go. In fact, some others said, well, we have the spirit of prophecy. And the Bible says all spirits are to be tested. And they must subject themselves to what? The Word and the Word alone. And so we believe in the last days, God will pour out His Spirit upon all flesh. His young maidens will have dreams and visions. And God will, but everything that happens must be in conformity to the Word and the Word alone. And so I want to encourage you. We're going to get those booklets for you. We're inviting you to come and to experience together one after another. But I also want to challenge our elders to join me in this. Not only are we going to go and look at information, but by the way, it's not about information. God gives us information, knowledge for transformation. But we also want to touch on something. What are the benefits of these teachings? Because we do live in a day and age where maybe older generations just wanted raw facts. But at the heart of it, we want to know, so what? What impact does this have on my life? And we want to look at the benefits of each and every one of these teachings. Will you stand with me? I want to invite you to personally take time and do something that David did. He said, Lord, search me and try me and see if there's any wickedness in me. And you might say, wickedness? You see, God is totally true and He's consistent. You know what's wicked? When I profess one thing, but I live totally the opposite. That's wicked. It robs God of the glory He deserves. It robs other people who need the Lord so that they can see Christ in all His beauty. And it robs me of my own life and salvation. Remember, at the end time, the Bible says there'll be a group of people at the coming of the Lord who will say, but Lord, in your name, I did this. And the Lord will say, what? I don't know you. Why? Because what they declared and what they demonstrated were not consistent. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we separate from this very place. We pray, Holy Spirit, do not leave us, do not forsake us. You are able to lead us to go deeper with you. You are able to bring out those very areas of our lives that need to have the light of heaven shine upon. Take us out of darkness. Lead us to walk in your ways. Change us and allow us to become men and women of integrity, honest, authentic, real people who reflect the loving, holy God that we are calling people to. We pray this, and we ask this by your grace in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's sing a closing song together.